Welcome back to Let's Play, it's Interactively Play Sorcery. I am the RPG Chick, and this is a Let's Play series where you get to choose at the end of the video what choice we will make going forwards. So I'm just going to click. I just want to see if we're in sync here. So I clicked out. Click. Alright. So I'm going to restart the recording here because I don't know if we're in audio video sync. We're having problems lately. I think it might be fixed, but let's play it safe for the next couple videos anyway. Okay. So what I do here? Right. I try to read this thing's mind. There's a skull on the ground, or partially in the ground. Apparently he wants water. Says I look good in the cap I was using to read its or his mind. So anyway, it was unanimous last episode. Everyone thought we should get him some water, or try to. So I can get you some, and I will actually try to. You say cagily. The head cracks like a tapped egg into a smile. Bless you, stranger. You've got a good soul. Well, good souls. what do I get in return? What do I get in return? The head wiggles its eyebrows. All right, the head replies, somewhat annoyed, though I'm not sure what I can do for you. Okay, so it's a skull, but it has eyebrows, which it can wiggle somehow. I want to know what you're doing here. Kind of a combination of both of these, but I can only choose one, right? I want to know what you're doing here. I'm being punished for my crimes, the head replies. Obviously. I'm not on holiday, but I promise you I'm reformed. I'm quite harmless now. Shades of Mort, indeed. What do you know about this place? What, this place? It's a punishment field. I have no idea how many other unfortunates are here. You can't even see them, and they quickly learn to be quiet. Why are they quiet? You ask. Sound attracts animals, the head replies. Lynch bugs, badu beetles, harpies. Not like we can defend ourselves. The head smiles thinly. Look, I can't keep talking or I'll die of thirst. Tell me about the land around here. Change the topic. I don't know much of Ishtara, but this valley belongs to Kariyama, the village in the mountains just east. The head squints up at you. We've met before, you know, the head remarks. You don't recognize me? I recognize you. There was someone else buried in the sand down south from here. I wonder if that's the same one? Met where? You demand, puzzled. You are sure you would have remembered a talking disembodied head had you encountered one before? Well, the head replies, if you don't remember, I'd best not remind you. The head mumbles something but keeps its lips closed. It clearly isn't going to speak any further. Interesting idea to get up the head, but you guys want me to get it water, so I'll get you that water. Not like I'm going anywhere, the head replies. Okay. Now, I think in this new land, I've just been up here. Let's head this way. I'm gonna try to find water. Normally would be over here somewhere. I'm completely sure. No, I'm thinking of this. this is the one. Well, we could go here, teleport here, and then go here. But maybe we'll find some water in the meantime. Let's go west and see what this is over here. In this new old land. You carry on tramping across the prairie. The sun continues to climb the steep sky. Nearby, you hear the sound of hammers on stone. Follow the sound. You approach the sound to find a group of workmen erecting a scaffold above near where the snake charmer's pit used to be. They ignore your approach. As you approach the scaffold, you are stopped by a large sphinx wearing a metal helmet. Stay back, the creature says. Big rocks high up. What are you building? You ask curiously. The seventh beacons. The seventh beacons? There's like way too many, typos. This one prevent collapsinating in the cloud mountains. Also make weather nice. Oh, this seventh beacons. Okay. He just doesn't speak good English. Okay. He turns to glance over his shoulder and shout incomprehensible insults at a group of worker sphinx who are clambering about in the upper reaches of the frame. How does a beacon prevent avalanches? You ask. The sphinx shrugs. Magic is magic, he answers. We know. This high, this wide, this strong. Strong enough to hold Oliphant. The rest is them problem. He jerks a thumb in the general eastward directions. Direction. Oliphant, what? Why would you put Oliphant in a tower? He smacks one side of his head in reply. Not Oliphant, heavy as. You stupid. The scaffold sits in a deep pit in the ground, which is being used to hold foundations. I need to cross the mountains to the east, you tell him. The sphinx shrugs. Use the bridge. We built for this. There's a crash from the site, and the sphinx turns around and roars, stomping back toward the construction. Let's follow him. You follow him curiously, and see that one of the bamboo supports has bent and buckled under the weight of two sphinx, who are now clinging on like spider monkeys above the pit below. The sphinx to whom you were talking is scratching his belly and trying to work out what to do. Let's try to help them. You step forward, intending to assist, then realize you do not know what to do. The two creatures are some height up and swaying violently back and forth. The leader is scratching his chin, clearly thinking hard. I'm thinking a giant size spell. Well, I can wait. I can cast a spell. Slice the bamboo in half. Well, that would be dooming them to falling. Let's cast a spell. You open your eyes to begin a spell, but the sphinx knocks your hands down on reflex. None that, he scolds. We engineers. With that, he goes over to the edge of the pit and collects two unused bamboo rods and lays them down across the pit. He then gathers another two, and you quickly realize he is building a support framework to allow the stranded sphinx to climb down. Well, so much for a spell. Let's look around the site. You take advantage of the distraction to walk around the site and poke into the materials they have in their stores. It is mostly, as you might expect, bamboo, hardwood for cutting joists, and various hammers, chisels, and lathes. If there is to be stonework, that must be arriving later. Behind all of this is a small metal box with a catch on the lid. Small metal box. Go check it out. So they made these bridges to the east then. That's pretty cool. Open the box. You squat down and open the box to reveal a small blue crystal. It is currently dark, but looks very similar to the ones you have seen previously on the towers. I don't think I should be taking this, guys. I don't think they can finish construction of the tower without it. I'm going to leave it. I'm really tempted somewhat to take it, but I'm going to leave it. You flip the box closed once more. Whatever the jewel is presumably important to the builders. The rest of the materials on the site are uninteresting except for a sharp-edged hewing axe. I'll take that. You pick it up and quietly slip it into your pack. Then it is time to go. You move on, leaving the workers to their task. Let's check out our item. Thief. We're a thief! Hewing axe. Intended for chopping through wood and foliage. Oh! That's gonna be helpful. We have this too, spike throwing this. We have been traversing through foliage. Not sure. This just leads back that way. Let's go this way for now. East. Oh, we're back in the... You continue across the endless dusty plains, and the grass turns to dust as you go. The sun has reached its highest point now. Out of the shade, the air is baking hot. Despite their size, the wind has scoured away the tracks you saw here earlier. You stride onwards. You are beginning to feel hungry. We're back in the desert. All right. Let's... You walk for half an hour across the fertile grassland. The sun is beginning to lower. The air begins to cool. The workers are still laying foundations nearby. You leave them to their task, blah blah. What about this? You walk out across the plain until you meet the edge of an old road. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. It will be dark soon. These plains stretch away, featureless and blank. The arrow fired by the centaur into the dirt is still here. Alright, let's pull that free. You tug the arrow from the dirt. See, I didn't dare do it in front of them. The shaft is as thick as your finger, the metal tip the size of a whetstone. You slide it into your pack as a souvenir. As you walk away, you seem to see a cloud of dust and three shapes riding across the plains, but they are lost in the corner of your eye and are gone when you turn your head. Huh. Weapons, maybe? Hefty arrow. Okay. Continuing to march. Now, have we been across the bridge? I can't remember. It's the perils of playing something like a week's worth apart. You leave the clear road and cut across the grassy fields that have somehow replaced the plain that was here before. The sun has all but gone. The road is a solid flagstoned track, not grand but serviceable enough. It is clearly frequently used by farmers' wagons and supply carts, though how any of these cross the river is a mystery. Look along the road. The road curves eastwards towards the stone tower. A smaller track winds north between clumps of trees. Look at the river. You cast a glance toward the river. Water rushes past at a tremendous rate. It seems incredible to think this will ever dry up, but you can understand that when it does, it will take the whole valley with it and leave only desolate dust behind. You walk forwards. Might be just refreshing my memory. Oh, water! Water! For the gourd. Sweet. Another night begins. You should try to find a place to sleep, especially after so long walking with an empty belly. You follow the old road to the edge of the river. The grassy plains stretch away once more. Behind you, the river roars and screams. A mighty bridge spans the river here. Fill the gourd with water. You lean into the river and fill up the gourd. Let's rest. The riverside is an attractive spot to rest, and the sound of the river is soothing. Laying your pack down on the grass, you try to stretch out despite the wind. You have not yet eaten today, but you have no rations to nourish yourself. Well, nothing steal my pack, please, while I'm gone. You close your eyes and let your tiredness overtake you. What is left of the night is restless with visions. The fearful specter of a death wraith looms up from the ground, but then seems to stumble, and a set of wooden false teeth fall from between its gray lips. A mechanical winch the size of the moon is turning, raising an old bucket from a chasm into the ground. It reaches, and the top... It reaches to the top, and a thousand snakes begin to pour out, covering your body and crawling into your boots and tunic. Yeesh. Through it all, you feel the heat of Annalan burning, should your quest fail. North of the Fisher, day 16. During the past day, you found no new clues. You pick yourself to your feet once more. The sound of the river is still with you. It has not disappeared into the night. You must explore these fields further. Yeah. We've been here. We crossed it to get over here, I think. So let's head back toward the skull. Or head, I'm not completely sure. You make your slow way across the lush prairie, enjoying the soft chirping of the insects. The early morning sun makes the air glow. You continue on your way. I'm not completely sure. He's over here somewhere, I think? I can only go... Let's go this way. You step off the clear road and walk across the now gray plain. The air moves a little, still icy, but fresh. You stride on. I think he's over here? I'm sure. You carry on tramping across the grassland. The day is likely to be clear and will be hot once more. A clatter of wheels makes you turn your head. A cart is approaching, driven by a broad figure in a long cloak. Greet the figure. You step into the cart's path and raise a hand. The figure raises a fist in return. Stranger, calls the figure. Do you want blood? What manner of creature are you? You demand. The driver throws back her hood and grins. I am the butcher of Badubak. Steak of Oliphant? Blue hide of Snatticat, ribs of goats. Your stomach rumbles at the thought. What do you fancy? Okay, I thought we were going to have a fight, and so she wants to sell me food. Sweet, I got money, and no food, so let's trade. The driver gestures with a brandished cleaver to the back of her cart, from which a thin river of blood trickles. I'm not going to mess around, let's buy something. You nod. I'll buy something from you. She beams with pleasure. What'll it be? The elephant steak is 7 gold pieces, blue hide is 10. The steaks are bloody and raw, and will be no good without cooking. Tempted to buy both, but we have to cook them first. So I'm guessing we can't just use them as rations outright. Let's just buy the elephant steak then. Excellent choice, the butcher replies. She jumps down and tosses back the canopy, pulling a bloody joint from the pile in the back of the wagon. She holds them out by the bone towards you. Tempted to cast a spell, but she might not like that. Can you cook it for me? She barks a laugh. What do you think I am, an innkeeper? Cook it yourself. Can you wrap it? You hand over 7 gold pieces and she gives you the meat. Wrapped in a short length of muslin cloth, you put it carefully into your pack. Raw meat must be cooked before it will serve as a ration. With that, the butcher whips up her oxen and rolls away across the plain. Alright, how am I going to cook this? I got a tinderbox. I'm going to have an option to build a fire. At some point. Raw meat. Alright. Let's find the head. Wherever the freaking head is hiding.
Look
Look for the head. The rising winds finger at your hair and cloak. You walk back through the long, lush fields. Look for the head. Are you there? You call out. Down here, replies the head. You find it in the grass. Did you bring water? Please say you did. Egg in the water. You open your pack and take out the water gourd. The head follows your every movement with insatiable curiosity. Then it throws back its upper jaw in excitement. You squat down and pour the water into its mouth. It coughs and sputters, drinking to clear its mouth, but not wanting to stop. Wonderful, it declares. You have no idea how wonderful. That'll keep me going, oh, another day at least. Let's try to dig him up. Yeah, I'm really curious. I'll get you out of there, you declare. The head jiggles. That would be a great idea, it agrees. I'd be more grateful than you can imagine. Cast a spell for what danger? Or to help dig it up. Or either. Well, I'm not gonna cast a lightning bolt at it. Zip is teleportation we do not have. Protect from magic. Interesting. This doesn't come up often. Protect from magic. That creates quicksand. Cause depression. I don't see the use for that. Clone the caster. The only thing I think can think is we take him out, he's going to fight us for some reason. Grow in size. I'm going to forego. I kind of wanted to cast, you know, a detect danger kind of thing. But, S-U-S, I think it was. Or Z-E-N, but we don't have that option. Pick up the head. You grab the head by the hair and tug the same way you pulled free the skull you found before, but it must be rooted in the ground or clinging on as you cannot get it to move. The head squeals. Stop that! Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! You let go. Alright, dig in the mud. You scrape into the mud either side of the head with your hands, trying to get underneath it. There seems to be some kind of neck below the chin, which goes down into the ground. Are you seriously going to dig me out with your fingernails? The head asks, because that's going to take a long time. I'm not using my sword. It's not giving me an option. I'm afraid I'm gonna default to the +2 sword and dull the blade, making it no longer a +2 sword. Cast a same thing, right? It's gonna be the same thing. Yeah, grow in size to dig quicker? We'll do that. You weave the spell, quickly swelling to the height of a tree. The head gasps in shock. Stamp on the head! With fingers the size of shovels, you tug away the clods and earth around the head to discover it is in fact a man, buried up to his neck in the ground. As the spell fades, he clambers to his feet and dusts himself down. Blessed Throth, he breathes. I can hardly believe it. Turning to you, he lowers his eyes in solemn acknowledgment. I am quite clear. I owe you my life. I will repay the debt any way I can, though I have little to offer. Gradually, you shrink back down to your normal size. He thinks for a moment. Perhaps marriage would be of use to you? Marriage? You demand, startled. To you? He shrugs. I've got better prospects than circumstances might suggest. No, you reply simply. He nods. Very well. He pats down his pockets. I have nothing to offer you. They're going to search him. I require information, you tell him. He shrugs. I've been buried in the ground for some time, but I'll tell you what. I'll go back to Kariyama and find out what I can. If we meet again, I'll give you the meat of it. Acceptable? It will do. He nods. And so we are quits. Be well. He flicks up his hood. Suddenly you realize where you have seen him before. This is the creature you encountered by the whirlpool, on the south side of the fissure. You vowed revenge should you find him. This is the one who stole one of my amulets or something? I recognize you. You cry, you are a thief. You already know I'm a thief, he shrugs. You should try a new career. He shakes his head. It's the only one I know. Let him go. You step back and gesture at him to leave. The moment of revenge has passed, it seems. Then with a flamboyant wave, he sets off across the field at a run. After a few paces, he seems to trip on something, but he quickly gets up, apologizes to something you cannot see, and is gone into the mists of the backlands. Okay, he tripped over another head, apparently. Okay, I think I'm done here. What I want to do is get to the other side. In the past, around here is another one of those serpents. There were some, I'm not sure what they were, hobgoblins or dwarves, something like that. They were running from something big. It has to be one of the serpents. The shepherd here was here earlier. Let's just go here. Let me look. Yeah. Let's go here. Let's see. I don't know. I want to cook that meat. Head to the tower. Oh, the blue crystal, I can touch it? Oh, you'll be in the lift uppers. Okay. Yeah, let's go there. I was hoping I would get my points back, but adjust the beam. Actually the beam is fine, isn't it? With the beacon blazing away, you swing yourself over the battlement once more. The climb down is easier this time. Alright, we climb down this way. I forgot about that. You clamber back down the outside of the tower. Time to rejoin the road? Well, okay. What's shining? That's a good question, isn't it? We're shining this way. So what's making this? Maybe that is? I want to return this area to the old land. But I believe it's down here we want to go. Unless it's that one. I don't think so. And I'll try to go down that way and see if we can find it. I'd like to have more stamina. The plain turns to rock and stone. The sun is sinking. It will be night soon. Rocks litter the path. Nestled between two rocks is the same whirlpool you saw earlier, although perhaps it is slightly smaller now? I'm just gonna move on. Back by the cave. It sounds like I'm cooking the stuff. Let's go south. Yeah, I want to cook it. Am I gonna get an option here to cook the food? Look at the aisle. Have I seen this? The east-west road into the mountains branches north here. In the elbow of the junction is a small stone idol. You pause to look down at the idol, which was definitely not here before. Right? The stone appears to be carved into the shape of an iguana. It stands upright on its tail, fingers splayed. Iguanas don't have fingers. Toes. A pictograph in the old hand is written beneath. Read the pictograph. The pictograph reads Sorceress. The fingers of the gecko, you notice, are pointing eastwards up the mountainside. Touch it? You pause to touch the idol, but receive no particular blessing from it. Perhaps its purpose is merely to inform. You stride forwards. Alright. Let's try here. What's it say? At the cliffside? Once more you enter the shadow of the cliffs that surround this place. The first few stars appear. In the darkness, the cliff is mere shadow. Rest. You look about for somewhere to rest, but this area feels too exposed, and the opening you slept in earlier seems to have vanished. You would do better to keep moving. You turn back northwards. Northwards. Alright, let's go here. The road leads away from the shadow of the cliff. The stars are carpeting the sky. A few small creatures scuttle across the flagstones of the old road. You continue to march through the dark. There's a cliff here. Rest here? Let's try to rest here. There is no shelter at the foot of the cliff, though there is less wind than at the top. But without a bolt hole to nestle in, you will be at the mercy of any creatures that smell you out. And there are not many hours of night left. Let's rest here anyway. Putting down your pack by the foot of the cliff, you try to rest despite the strange noises that float across the landscape. You have eaten nothing today, but there is nothing you can do to abate your hunger. You're right. I have a tinderbox. There's nothing I can light to cook this thing. You lie back and try to forget your troubles. The long night is filled with vivid dreams. A small rabbit hops up to your feet, quite tame, then raises its eyes, which burn bright and terrible red, with all the force of a red eye of Kari. Mocking laughter seems to ring in your ears. Cliff base. Day 17. During the past day, you lost some gold. 7, and found no new clues. Morning comes. You rise, brush the dust from your cloak, and look about you. I don't want to climb back up the cliff. You turn your eyes to surrounding wastes. This is where we came from. But the creature is here. We just have to turn... I don't know. We gotta mess with the towers. Let's head back for the tower. I don't know. I want to defeat that serpent before we move on. Dolmen is gone. The path beckons. I'm just randomly trying to even places. Alright, gonna mess with it. If I can climb up there. Ripweed. Adjust the beam. So let me just see. What is illuminating this area? It's not this one. Turn it back. So I feel like turning it that way. Let's go here. Oh, it's rubble. I can't adjust it. Turn it that way. I guess we could... Well, let me just look over here. See, what is illuminating that area? I can't... I don't understand. I'll just face it that way. This one was facing that way. This shouldn't be it shouldn't be illuminated, I don't think. Sorry guys, trying to figure this out. Let's go here. Oh, I am there. No, now I'm there. This way we can get across. You return outside. The toilet tower stands open. Oh. So wait, I need to use the bridge to cross. I ruin my stuff if I cross. Ugh. Alright, cast a spell. Floating? Whichever one. No, not future. Hover in the air. You are not floating high enough to clear the scorched and charred bushes, so gain no extra visibility. That's fine. Alright, cross here. You splash through the water, but after a while it seems to dry up, leaving only dry rock. You make your way easily to the other side. In all directions, the forest has been replaced by a marsh, except for here, a small bald plain of rock. A little way to the southeast, at least, the stone tower still rises, though it is dwarfed by the violet mountains behind. Alright, we're going to climb so we can cross this way. Your weight returns and you settle gradually back down to the ground. Darkness closes in. You should find a suitable spot to sleep, especially after so much walking on an empty stomach. A towering structure looms over you, dwarfing the mounds and marsh plains. Marsh plants. Rest? I wish I could cook that thing. Clambering up one of the mounds of earth by the bottom of the arch, you settle down on dry ground. You have not yet eaten today, but your pack is empty, and you cannot satisfy your belly. Hmm. You stretch out and rest. The remainder of the night is kept busy with visions. From somewhere overhead, you hear a boy's voice. He shouts your name once, twice, before leaping through the air only to land in the wide-open jaws of a gigantic sand lion. The jaws close and the boy disappears, and all the while you hear distant laughter from the east. Is it the boy that we told his future? Day 18. During the past day you found no new clues. Yeah. Milky sunshine breaks through the haze over the marsh. You get back to your feet. Yes. Seeing that climb? Huh. You briefly scour the pillar for suitable handholds, but the stone is featureless and smooth. Without the thousands of years of weathering that gave you the grips you used for your last climb, there is no way up onto the bridge from here. You stride onwards. I think it's over here. If we don't sink in the marshland. The sky is blue and pink. You stand on a bald rise surrounded by thick mud and long swishing reeds. The tower is a little way to the southeast. The marshland dries up into thick forest once again. You are back amongst the trees of Snada. A few clouds hurry across the sky. Huh. Alright. Let's see if I can climb here. Time to move on. We're going this way now. You continue across the soaring bridge. The sun has reached its highest point now. Out of the shade, the air is baking hot. There are no handrails here. Sitting by the sheer drop at the edge of the road is a starving-looking man, with legs folded beneath him and head bowed to the stone. He is perhaps asleep, or drunk, or dead. Okay. Doesn't seem like that great of a choice, but we've been running for a while. Did we find this man before? Well, I don't think so. So what do you think? Should we try to wake him? Should we watch him first, or should we move on? Forget him. Leave your votes, leave your comments in the comments section below. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Let me know what I should do next. And until next time, endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.